Welcome to the webcast introducing domain-specific modeling. Engineering software is all about bridging the gap between the solution expressed in the problem domain terms, shown here in the red area, to its implementation in the machine code running on the hardware, shown in the blue area. Regardless of what kind of software you are developing, finding a solution always starts by expressing that solution in the terms of your problem domain. Once you have defined your solution, you can then map it into the implementation in your code. Over the years, technologies have helped the software engineer to raise the level of abstraction closer to the problem domain by providing better programming languages, such as Fortran or C, for instance. And then these languages have automation mechanisms that provide and translate the specifications in those languages to lower abstract machine code. This has made software development much more productive and less complex than before. Newer programming languages, such as Java or C#, have changed this picture very little. To raise the level of abstraction further to tackle the complexity and growing size of software, modeling languages such as UML or SysML were introduced. UML, for instance, provides software engineers a way to make a visual plan of the code before writing that code. The problem with this approach is that it forces the developer to solve the same problem several times. First, in the problem domain concepts, then in UML models, and finally in the code. UML, unfortunately, does not raise the abstraction level further, does not assist software engineer in making correct designs because it's a general purpose, allows only very little code to be generated from it. As a result, engineers trying to apply UML typically throw those models away once they start coding. With domain-specific modeling, we can continue to raise the level of abstraction closer to the problem domain. We do this not by trying to visualize the code, but by providing highly tailored modeling languages that visualize the problem domain and therefore guide modelers into making correct designs. Modelers design applications here visually with the concepts that mimic closely real-world objects, and then also enable generating the lower-level code from these designs. Let's look next at a practical example. While each domain is different and have a specific language, I'll use here a domain we already know and are familiar with, time. We have here a domain-specific languages for digital wristwatches. This company makes different kind of watch products for different market segments, but all applications somehow deal with time and provide different kind of features like timer, world time, stopwatch, lap time, and so forth. The actual watches that we implemented here, we can then target different executing languages like C, Java for, let's say, Android, or C# for Windows or Windows phones. Let's inspect next these in a modeling tool. And I apply here MetaEdit Plus. MetaEdit Plus is a modeling tool and also language development tool. What we have here is two different kind of languages. I have here a language for describing watch family. And we have here five different kind of watches. Ace, Delicia, Sporty, Celestron, and Celeste. If I click here one of these models, now I can see that this language says that the model called Ace is a watch for an adventure person, and each watch contains one display and one logical behavior. If you look this display definition in more detail, we can see that each display contains a set of icons, unit zones like minutes, seconds, hours, and a set of buttons. And this language allows me to add new icons and buttons, but restricts now the design space into this domain. So what this describes now is a structure of the display. Watch must also do something, and there is also behavior. And what I have here is a description of the behavior side, and some of these can be reused for multiple watches. So let's see the behavior. If I go and put a battery to my watch, it goes to a time, from time to an alarm, from alarm to a stopwatch, and I can also go and see what looks individual watch applications, like here, stopwatch. And we could now add here more features. But here the language is a little bit different than in this watch family language. Now the modeling concepts that I have here are visible in the toolbar, like actions, alarms, buttons, displays, icons, and so forth. So I now design my application using these high-level concepts. So we could, for example, add here a lap time feature. So by pressing a certain button when we are running the time, we could freeze the display to show the current elapsed time. And then pressing maybe the button again, we could go back to see the current stopwatch time. So let's add here a new state called lap time. And then I can connect my lap time state by saying that once our time is running, then we can go to a lap time. Then of course I need to say somehow that what triggers this transition. And now when I'm using the domain concepts, I could reuse some of these buttons and say that, well, if I press the down button, then I can trigger this transition. This language now also knows rules of this domain. So if I want to do some silly things like connect this button to this icon, it doesn't allow me to do that. It only allows me to do correct kind of designs, like these. Also, I can have other kind of designs that if I, for example, add here functionally like actions, which are not related to any of my designs, I can run a number checkers or annotate my model directly to see that there are some things that I need to correct before I continue. And to finalize this application, let's add here the action, and this language has the support for arithmetics, so I can calculate also the time here. So I could say that let's calculate the lap time by taking system time minus start time and put the result into stop time. So now we are done. As you saw, all the modeling concepts I'm using here are high-level language concepts. There are no programming concepts here. So let's next look if our lap time is working. I can choose here different generation targets in which we would like to generate the code, and in this case we could generate the code into Java and also animate our models while we are using it. So here is all the generated code, and now we have different kind of watch applications here visible. So let's go to this ACE model and let's go there to the lap time feature. So now we are in this state called stopped. If I press up button, it triggers the transition, puts the icon on, calculates the time to be shown in this display, and we are now in running state. But now if I press the down button, now we went to this newly created lap time. And we see the current lap time here. And nothing should happen with the other buttons unless we press a down button again. As you noticed, none of the concepts in this language deal with implementation, low-level detailed coding concepts. The language raises our abstraction level, allowed us to build the applications very fast. So what is domain-specific modeling? With this example, you show that domain-specific language aims to capture domain knowledge, not to visualize code. Visualizing code helps very little. So the language itself uses domain abstractions and domain concepts as modeling constructs. So the engineers don't need to learn any new language. They can use the concepts they already know in their domain. And the language also narrows down the design space. It also means that the developers can design the product using domain terms. So they can work with the already existing concepts, only solve the right kind of problems, and only solve the problems once in the model. No need to update models and code or make the changes into multiple files because the files are generated, so code files are generated, and no round tripping at all. Thank you for your time. If you want to play with this example language, you can download it at metacase.com download. More examples on domain-specific modeling, please have a look at our DSM examples webcast, because seeing an example that is closer to your problem domain will likely help you in assessing the applicability of domain-specific modeling in your organization. Thank you for watching.